Yes, today we continue with loom weights actually, and from a little bit different perspective, since I'm not an expert in textile but an archaeologist that works with textile. And this is also not a paper about big transformations but about the micro scale of transformation in craft production as it can be seen, as I think it can be seen in the archaeological material. And I have to make some, very quick introduction because there is no time to talk about the background. We might discuss later, but let's say to follow my line of thought, you should give for granted, believe me, that one of the big Bronze Age innovations, we have been working with it in Gothenburg for some time now, it's supposed to be an introduction of wool around in the third millennium. So, in the area of the Near East and Anatolia, you have clear evidence of intense wool production. The first traces of wool already from the fourth millennium. But and they are documented in many different ways, including archive documents. So we have numbers, we have names of people working with wool and so on and so forth. In the second millennium BC, we start having fragments of wool in the continent, and including the big collection of woolen clothes from Denmark that has been recently analyzed with strontium isotopes by Karin Frey in Copenhagen. The surprising result was that the wool of this cloth doesn't look to be done with sheep that have been grazing in actual Danish territory. So they really strongly suggest that there was wool trade in Europe by the second millennium, mid-second millennium BC. And we know that wool cannot be really easily produced with Bronze Age sheep, because Bronze Age sheep don't look like modern sheep. They have very little wool, so you need a lot of them in order to produce enough wool to have an economically sustainable production. So it's very possible that you had centers of production and then wool trade in the style that you could see already 1,000 years before in the Eastern Mediterranean. And one very good candidate for this wool production, I believe, is located here in the Po Plain in northern Italy, where I'm working with, where you have evidence of high numbers of sheep among the animal population and a lot of textile tools. As I said, the whole chain opératoire, it's a complicated one, it's a year-round activity. Bronze Age sheep are different from modern sheep. They require different technology. You can shear them, you pluck the wool from them. And then, as you can see, there's several different steps. They keep different people busy. And what we are going to focus today is the weaving part, which is the last one. In the Po Plain, which is the Middle Bronze Age and Italian Middle and Recent Bronze Age culture, so called the terramare culture, you have evidence from all these steps, from the sheep herding to the weaving. And actually, if you look at the archive documents, you understand, and of course those who practice, they also know, that the weaving part, it is the final part, and it takes, if you think about time, maybe the least time, it's the quickest part of the whole process. But it has very important, it's a key moment, because if the weave, it's a poor quality, actually, this whole chain of product doesn't really have any economical sustainability. The product, it's not sellable, it's not usable. So I think it's a pretty fundamental step, nevertheless. This is a rock in Valcamonica where, if you have good eyes, or maybe you know, you can see a lot of looms, like this one, with a loom weight. There is some 10 of them if you want to exercise. Weaving is also, it's also a social craft, because it's something that requires teaching, to tutoring, you need to practice, and you need a dialogue between the one that teaches you and the one that is learning. There is a lot of ethnographical evidence of large looms where you have one or two or three people working together, so weavers. So I think there is a lot of professional interaction around weaving. And this is why in this paper I wanted to talk about the introduce what I believe it fits very well, the material, the concept of community of practice that I have been getting familiar with recently. And in order to for archaeologists to help in the approach to the material, to a different approach to the material culture, not only look at the tools, but look at the tools as the result of this professional interaction between people. So they are the results of a practice that was going on. And a community of practice, if you want for a general definition, so it's a group of people who share a concern or a passion. It's very used in modern studies about a lot of different internet communities too, for something they do and learn how to do better as they interact regularly. So I think it fits very well with the weaving process. And more in detail, in order to have a working community of practice, you need to have, it's called domain. So it's a shared competence. People do the same things all together. They interact about this domain that they are concerned with. There is a community, so members that engage in activities and discussion, help each other, share information, as I believe, for example, between masters and tutors, between weavers. And there is the practice. And the practice is the repertoire of resources, experience, stories, tools that you use. And this is distinguished the group, the community, from other people doing other things. And I think that in archaeology we have the possibility to find, to discuss all three products, because we could see the practice through the loom weights that we have. The nature of the weaving, this what I believe is social interaction for the weaving process, helps to construct the domain. And the analysis of the tools, which I'll try to demonstrate, to show now briefly, I think it can help us to find the key to interpret the domain. So how this this craft production develops and transforms. This is the area where I have been working, so the pop lane in northern Italy. And as you can see, it's a densely populated area. It's it starts around 1600. It is basically a forest before 1600. So yeah. and it's a rapidly growing culture. The settlements increase in numbers, and with time they're also, there are changes. Some settlements become much bigger. Generally, in the beginning, they are around 1 hectare, 2 hectare, and at the end of the recent growing stage, you have 20 hectares, too. And some stop existing. So we cannot go in any detail. Some of these places have been excavated, and there is several textile tools, and I've been looking at a published and well-published textile tool, and these are these three sites that I will mention. I particularly am working with Montale, which is, this is how typical terramare settlements look like, with the ditch and embankment. This is the Montale site, this is the site, the embankment, and the large ditch. It was 40 meters wide, so it's quite impressive. The settlement itself is only 1 hectare. As you can see here, the modern excavation have been just working here. All the rest has been shoveled away in the 19th century because it was used as compost. It was very rich, dark soil, and it was spread all around to make fertile agriculture. But these excavations are very accurate, and there is a lot of also loom weights that were collected by the museum people, the local museum people, during the compost quarry. They were there and they were taking all the archaeological objects that were shooed away. So we have nowadays, there are 144 loom weights from the site and 17 from the modern excavation in this little area. This is the excavation area, very small, and in phase two, they could see two houses here is the 3D reconstruction of how they could look like. It's a very densely inhabited landscape, settlement. And this phase two loom weight, out of the 17 from the whole 11 phase, 10 of them come from this house here. And this is where I start thinking about grouped community of practice and specific sets of tools, because all of them are of cylindrical form. There is many different kinds in the whole collection from Montale, but all of those from this house are cylindrical. And as you can see here, they had one in the red square. If you see, this one is the weight, and this one is the diameter of the face with the hole. They, well, these are all the loom weights from Montale. They all have a relatively similar diameter, but the weight spread from 400 grams up to 1.5 kilo. And the one from phase two, they're all also, they're similar in shape, but different in weight. And I was thinking if this is a feasible way to work with. And in the neighbor site of Santa Rosa, you have a similar situation. You have two houses with the two lines of loom weights found on the floor, which have been interpreted as one standing loom. And the situation is rather similar. They have many different weights, as you can see here. And somehow, at least a group of them, relatively similar diameter. And what's more interesting, they all have very similar shapes. So, and these two houses and the house from Montale are contemporary. So my idea is that actually there is some sort of groups, community, that work with textile in a similar fashion in different villages at the same time, using relatively similar loom weights with different weights. So there are light and heavy ones used at the same time. In Santa Rosa here, you can see that the light ones are in the middle of the loom and the heavy ones at the two sides of the loom, which is something that in some, it is recorded ethnologically. We have another in the next phase, in the Middle Bronze Age 3, there is another site where a possible loom has been found. And here you can see that in the next phase, something has changed, because looms are really similar. They have, I don't know the picture, but they look the same. They also have similar decoration, but they are not very different in weight anymore. There is a relatively limited range of weight. So it feels like there is a different set, maybe a different way of weaving, or maybe the technology has developed all over. We don't have, unfortunately, many well-dated loom weights from Montale to say that. But we have, from the 19th century excavation, group of looms that look very much the same. They have a similar decoration, and some of them, like this one, they have almost exactly the same weight. So they really look very much like that something similar to what could be seen in the Middle Bronze Age 3 at Beneceto is happening at Montale too. Then Montale stopped existing in Risen Bronze Age 1, and in Risen Bronze Age 2, in another site that becomes much larger. You have a house with many loom weights. One that a group that had been interpreted as a loom, and one as an area where they were just kept. And all the loom weights from this late period are very heavy. So maybe it's also a change in fibers. They are all about 1 kilo. So something has happened. And you remember, Montale was very similar. Poviglio, this one was very similar to Montale in the Middle Bronze Age too. But now it has changed completely. And this is again a Montale, all that stops before the recent, and during the Risen Bronze Age 1. So you can see that until the Risen Bronze Age 1, it seems that everyone is using loom weights below 1 kilo. And in the next phase, like in Poviglio, they become above 1 kilo. So there is a lot of dynamic going on in the, I'm coming to the conclusion, in the plane. The weights of the loom weight, it changed very much during the different phases. And I will not go in any detail, I just say that. I try to compare with the Trentino Garda area, which is very close to this area, and other archaeological evidence show a lot of interaction between these two areas. And here you have a completely different situation. All the loom weights that have been found from the early Bronze Age until the final Bronze Age seem to have always a relatively limited range of weight below 1 kilo. And so it really talk about a completely different way of weaving or tools to weave. And the result, I don't know. The conclusion is that I think that there is reasons to see, to look for transformation in the archaeological material, even in this that could be considered like minor transformation, because the possibility that community of practice have to develop their craft or to adapt to external, for example, market possibility, it actually gives to the entire village the possibility to have a sustainable economy. And when the loom weights become very heavy in the rest of the plain, Montali actually stops existing. So it might be also something very big has happened there from the economical point of view that made not sustainable to live there anymore. And yeah.